especially want to welcome this particular session. Whoa, I'm going to get emotional already. Hopeless. So this is Tony Barry, who's over at Mullum, got his own personal experience of medical cannabis, and all the people here behind me, they're all heroes. I got to be honest. Because I've long thought it's easy for hippies in Nimbin like me, unemployed, dole bludgers. We can stand up and say we're smoking weed. But when you're out in mainstream, you got children, there's threats, they'll take your children from you. There's so much vilification, and we're really... Pot smokers are like a scapegoat, I reckon. It's a great word to look up the history on. And, you know, that's why so many people have come to live in the Nimbin area for the last 40 years. Serious medical cannabis users, daily users. If you come and live here, every chance your neighbour won't dob you in, which is a really big thing. And, you know, we understand each other, we support each other, and it's a bit extreme, but sometimes I think it's a bit like a leper colony, you know. We've all huddled back here and, you know, and we look after each other, and the outside world judges us. The fantastic thing is, in the last year, that's changed a little bit. It sounds better than it is, would be my point. I mean, when the media come on, or the acting Prime Minister opened a dope crop, which was actually an empty paddock, I've now found out, and he said, I loved his quote, he said something like, any plant from nature we can make a medicine out of and help people, we should use. That's the Prime Minister acting. Barnaby Joyce. He tried to cancel Malcolm's visa, I heard. Anyway, it's a really special crew behind me. Some of them I don't know really well. And lots of mothers, lots of people who are just full-on campaigning for medical cannabis. And they're listened to much more than hippies. Because I think lobbying politicians is probably what we have to do. You know, they're too busy. They don't really know what's going on with pot. Or they might, and they're pressured by their party not to do anything. But they're all going to be talking about it in the next year, and it's up to all of us, I reckon, if you're game, to contact your local Member of Parliament, ask for an appointment, go and talk to them. I can't find anyone who's opposed to medical cannabis, except maybe the directors of big pharma companies, the bosses of the police, who have conned themselves into thinking it's a dangerous drug and, you know, we should be locking people up. One of my big calls would be to try to separate cannabis from the other illegal drugs. It's the only completely natural one, unprocessed, very different. But at the moment, ICE is in the same basket as medical cannabis, which is crazy. So the laws have to change, and anything any of us can do is going to win points. Meanwhile, to me, it's like we're living in a parallel universe. I keep seeing statements from police or politicians or health ministers, like, you know, you can't use medical cannabis without seeing your doctor twice or three times, and we can't have backyard growers, it's all got to go through Big Pharma and TGA. Well, it's almost like the couple of million people who are regular users don't exist. So my plan is to overgrow the government. And I think over this weekend there's a few things we can do. I said last night at the opening, talk to the police. The police have a lot of power in this. The New South Wales Police Commissioner, Scipione, he's, I think, the biggest donator to the Hillsong Church. He's on $600,000 a year and they tithe you 10%. You know, he's a God-fearing bloke, and we're talking about a herb that the East called God's gift for thousands of years. So the irony is crazy, you know. So it's up to us to do as much education as we can, I think, and that's really what Mardi Gras is about, sharing knowledge, sharing our stories, encouraging each other. No one's going to get locked up on medical pot now, I reckon. You know, if you're a personal user, they're not going to lock you up. I'm really confident. But no one wants to get a criminal record. No one wants your neighbours seeing the police raiding you. I understand all that. Anyway, I'm going to hand over to Tony, who I really appreciate has come over, and he's going to introduce you to everyone because I won't get their names right. And nothing much more to say. Talk to the police, I thought. If you see the police, go up and talk to them. Tell them your medical story, tell them your experience, and while you've got them in conversation educating them, they're not searching some kids. That's my plan. Good on you.
We'll keep that for here. Please. Thanks, Michael. When Michael asked me to come along and MC this, I was delighted. I've been using medical marijuana for a while because of melanomas, but I was here in 1973 for the Nimbin Festival, and I'd just like to say for the record that I have smoked marijuana and I did inhale. But this is not about smoking pleasures of marijuana. This is about the medicinal capabilities of this plant. And you're going to hear from a lot of people here, a range of people this morning, about the experiences they've had with it. And first of all, we'd just like to show you a short film called Stone. Is that ready to go? Just a hand for Kath, who's been behind the scenes putting plenty of work in here too. Thank you.
I am Ty. I am 11. I was born healthy. In January 2010, I got sick.
I need your help. My son has epilepsy. E-P-I-L-E-P-S-Y.
Tara's had her first seizure at 6 weeks old. Upwards of 500 a day on a bad day. We were told Tara had 12 to 24 months to live.
And there's no medication that can stop or prevent these seizures. He's actually medication resistant.
The conventional drugs that are out there don't appear to be too effective, and also they have a lot of side effects.
He's got cataracts, he's lost his night vision, peripheral vision, brittle bones, the list goes on and on.
Now, I don't understand that. Why would you give a medication that has a side effect of seizures when you're trying to prevent it?
Opioid use is not without significant adverse effects.
So this is pure cannabidiol. It's a powder. It appears to be quite effective in reducing seizures in these children and bring them back from being bedridden, not being able to feed themselves or walk or talk, to fully functioning little kids.
It's been 310 days that I've been a criminal, and I draw it up and I hand it to Jai. So Jai's actually classed as a criminal as well, and he self-administers. When he woke up in the morning and I gave him his first dose, and he said his first words.
You need to hear the story of children totally healed with their epileptic seizures.
What the fuck? What's most interesting to me is everywhere you go where they've ended the drug war, hardly anyone wants to go back. We've given it a fair shot, right? We've given it 100 years, $1 trillion, untold hundreds of thousands of lives. I think the time is right to try the different approaches.
It's been very hard to do cannabinoid research because there's different regulatory and legislative hurdles that get in our way.
I can walk. I can talk. I can eat. I can play. I am
alive.
that film has obviously engendered emotional responses in the audience, but also up here, because some of the people on this panel have parents of children who featured in that film. And the format we're going to go, because these people have all got stories and they could go on all day about it, but what we're going to try and do is just take 5 minutes each to give a condensed version of the story, and then we're going to hand it over to you people, because I'm sure you'll have questions of these pioneers who have been trying to offer their children the opportunity to access this medicinal cannabis, simply to take them out of the realm of the, well, I won't go into what happens with some of those drugs, but so the first person we'd like to hear from, then we'll be having question time after. First person we'd like to hear from is Mercy. No, is Cheri. Sorry, Cheri. Mercy, Cheri.
Yeah, hi, I'm Tara's mum, who was on the clip there. Tara...
bit closer.
Tara has Dravet syndrome, which is one of the most catastrophic epilepsies known to man. In 2012, we were told that Tara had 12 to 24 months to live. This was after her having had 8 resusses in 2012, 6 of which I did. So numbers-wise, basically from 6 weeks right through to 7 years old, we did not have one day where she was seizure-free. Between that, we maybe had 6 in her non-medical cannabis life where she's had no seizures. Since starting on Mulloway's medical cannabis, Tara is now 1,122 days seizure-free. Yeah. She's now pharmacy free, she's walking, she's talking, she's running, her IQ's gone up by 30 points, she's toilet trained. To the layperson, you would not know what her life has gone through. And in that time of being on Mulloway's, we have prevented 224,400 seizures. Yeah. You know, we're a little different to some of the families. We've actually got 2 children who have similar disorders. So her older brother's not far behind her. He'll be 3 years seizure-free in late May. So, yeah, for us, it's been a journey. It's been a fight, and the fight hasn't ended. We're, you know, every week dealing with politicians and trying to push the cause, and, you know, we're not going to give up until this is available to everyone. You know, we are eligible under the Victorian legislation to join their new program, but, you know, we're one of the select few and we won't be taking up that offer. But we won't stop until it's available for everyone. So, yeah, that's pretty much our story.
Thanks, Cheri. Michelle.
My name's Michelle, I'm from Brisbane. My son Jai disappeared on that documentary. January 2010, life changed for us. He was diagnosed with 3 rare forms of epilepsy, no cure. Very complex child, up to 500 seizures a day for years after years. In December 2014, I made the choice to save his life and put him on Mulloway's medical tinctures. He was on 35 tablets a day, a combination of 5 AEDs, suffered horrific side effects from those pharmaceutical medications, and it got to the point where he wasn't going to get better. He wasn't getting better, and every tablet just kept taking and taking our son away from us. So I made the decision, and he experienced his very first seizure-free day after nearly 5 years of never having that. He's been now 15 months on Mulloway's. He's had 4 seizures during that time. So, you know, our... sorry.
Yeah.
So, you know, our experience is very similar to Cherie's. You know, where every drug you put in to your child, I call them drugs because, you know, when they're narcotics or when they're opiates or benzos, valiums, all of that, and high doses, you know, watching your child legally stoned, it's horrific. You feel like you're actually killing your own child. And now he is very much alive. He's thriving. He basically, you know, every aspect of his life was just being taken from, you know, not being able to eat, talk, walk, go to school, just be that typical 11-year-old child. So now he's got his first ever academic reports. He's attending school. He is able to feed himself. He is able to talk. He's able to communicate and feel. And I think that's, you know, probably the most important word I can get out there, because these children are zombies. You know, every aspect of who they are, they're empty shells. So our experience has been absolutely life-saving. Without this medicine, Jai would not be here today. We would have buried our son by now. So it's frustrating. It really is. But he's alive and he's well because of Tony Bauer. So.
Right. Thank you. Thank you. Michael.
Hello. My daughter, Caitlin Lambert, is 4 years old, and she has Dravet syndrome, like Cherie, Cherie's child, a rare catastrophic epilepsy which kills 1 in 6 sufferers before the age of 18. Dravet syndrome is called treatment-resistant epilepsy, refractory epilepsy, intractable epilepsy, drug-resistant epilepsy. There are no treatments registered for Dravet syndrome in the United States. Sufferers typically start seizing at 6 months. Seizures are uncontrolled, leading to permanent brain damage, sudden death from a seizure, or dying in your sleep via SUDEP, sudden unexplained death in epilepsy. They can also die from complications of epilepsy, such as tachycardia, ataxia, not being able to swallow and breathe properly. By 10 years old, most Dravet kids are basically severely retarded. Caitlin is on 3 daily medications, plus cannabis, plus her heart medicine. She's been on cannabis oil, high in CBD and CBDA for 1.5 years, and she's doing better, thank you. She is being properly monitored by her paediatrician and 2 neurologists. Caitlin is a wonderful child. She's a very happy child. She doesn't know she has any problems until she has a problem. And, boy, when she has a problem, it's pretty bad. There she is. Caitlin, she can't sing happy birthday. She can sing the first 2 words. She can't sing twinkle, twinkle. But every day with Caitlin is an absolute joy. Now, you'd think the government would help Dravet children, some of the sickest people in New South Wales. Caitlin faces sudden death, permanent disability. Once she's retarded, it's too late. We can't wait for something to happen in 5 years' time. We just wanted to be able to walk and talk and go to school next year. Now, so far there's been no help from New South Wales. There's no Schedule 9 permit so that we can legally possess cannabis medicine. There's no rescheduling of cannabis out of Schedule 9, which they should do straight away. There's no amendment to the Drug Misuse and Trafficking Act, so it is not a crime to be sick in New South Wales. We've been excluded from the medical cannabis trials because we're already using cannabis. They don't have enough anyway. We're being prosecuted by the New South Wales Police because it is a crime to be sick in New South Wales. I complained to the Discrimination Commissioner, and they said it was okay to discriminate against Dravet sufferers. As long as you make food and medicine a crime, it's not discrimination if you make it a crime to be sick. I had no grounds of complaint. I'm sorry, don't even bother writing the letter. They know Caitlin is in a very precarious position. She can be killed or severely damaged, just like these other families, these other children, at any time. But they won't help us, I believe, for three main reasons. If they help Caitlin, they have to help everybody else. There are no exceptional exceptions. All these people, all the people who are suffering, are equally as valid. You don't have to be a cute four-year-old girl to need compassion, to need medicine. The other reason they won't let you have medical cannabis is alcohol. The government gets 60 cents a stubby and lots of donations from alcohol companies. New South Wales Health won't allow Caitlin to have cannabis, but they allow the sale of an addictive drug beverages without any warnings on the pack. Alcohol causes cancer, heart disease, mental illness, death from overdose. There are no packaged alcohol warnings in New South Wales, despite that, the fact that alcohol kills 15 Australians every day. And the final reason, of course, is Big Pharma, the donations, the lobbying. And they're trying to protect the drugs they've got already and the drugs they've got in the pipeline, which are going to be rather expensive. Finally, what do they want me to do? Would you watch your daughter get more and more disabled every day? Or would you break a stupid law? What would you do if your daughter was a temporary Australian? One seizure away from unnecessary suffering. Cannabis helps us. It's food. The seed is good for you. It's medicine. It's anti-epileptic. It's an antioxidant. It's a neuroprotectant. It treats the whole endocannabinoid system. Caitlin is going to school next year, and I don't care if she's the dumbest child in the school. Caitlin is going to school next year, and she is bringing her cannabis with her. Happy Mardi Gras. Free the weed. Yeah.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Michael. And Mel and Lynn have come together on this one.
We're just going to show a short video that depicts Jeremy's life. I think if I could say one thing to you all is don't wait. Jeremy's 25 now, and he was diagnosed with refractory epilepsy when he was 6 years old. There's possibly no way we'll be able to turn back how well-trained his brain is to seize. But we home grow his cannabis in our backyard, in along against the tomatoes and the beans, and he's the healthiest he's ever been. Anyway, this is his story. Don't wait. Don't wait.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Debbie, who's next up, is a nurse who's had extensive experience with medicinal cannabis, yeah?
I wouldn't say extensive, but good morning. I am Debbie. I'm a nurse up in Queensland. I'm not really prepared for this, and I'm not a great public speaker, but that is why I'm here. I work in a mainstream acute hospital where I see pharmaceuticals doled out every day like lollies for these conditions and many others. I've been a nurse for a while. I was a transplant nurse for a long time, and I don't cry at very much, but this is just heartbreaking. I'm just here from the health side to say, if you are using medicinal cannabis for anything or know of people that are using it, speak up. Michael said speak to the police. I say talk to your doctors as well. Talk to your physios, all your allied health representatives, anyone you can talk to, speak to. 2 years ago, I couldn't talk about this in my main hospital, but now, like, it started from little conversations from me whispering in people's ears in tea rooms, telling people about stuff. Other people would overhear it, and they wouldn't come to me directly in front of everyone and say, what were you talking about? They'd wait till later and say, could you email me some info? And from that, it's just grown. You know, I have doctors, like half a dozen doctors, which doesn't seem a lot to you, but to me, in a hospital that ignored me for so long, ask me for their email, get my email address, I send them info, and they are talking about it. So as people in the public going to the systems, you can talk about it with these representatives, who then in turn can talk with their bosses. Like, I can't talk to my line managers about it unless yous are speaking up. I can't say, it's doing this, it's doing that. I know these kids that are healed when, you know, they aren't seeing it for themselves. So as a health representative, I can talk till the cows come home, but I need other people to speak up as well. Even if it's not you, if it's your grandma or your mate's grandma, get them to talk to, you know, their health representatives, even their politicians, like everyone here's been doing. The mindset here, they all know about it, but it's the ones out there that you need to convince, because otherwise, we're very few that are beating their heads up against the wall. That's from the health perspective, you know. There's many of you activists that are out there every day, but in the mainstream health system, we need everyone else's help to be able to speak to our bosses as well. Or these kids and many more are just not going to get anywhere. You know, it's the stigma that follows it. I'm very well aware of that, being in that system, but, like, I can talk to people about it, so can everybody else, you know, and at the end of the day, we will get somewhere. It's come so far in 2 years. So, like, my nurse unit manager will put up our medical cannabis petitions in my nurse's station. This is where the public walk past every day, so we are getting somewhere. I would have been thrown out 2 years ago for doing that. You know, I put posters up everywhere. So that's all I really want. That's the only reason I'm here. I don't have a great story. I just wanted just to know that, you know, if you're using chemo in conjunction with cannabis therapy, speak up, tell them when they offer you the ondansetrons or the anti-nausea medications and you go, oh, no, I don't need it, I don't get sick. Don't lie. Say, no, I'm going home and smoking a joint. I'm going home and eating cake. Tell them so they know that that's what you're doing, and refusing the pharmaceuticals, because we've all pretty much in this room can see the end result of what the pharmaceuticals will do. I am not saying there's not a place for them, but what I am saying is it can all be utilised. And cannabis shouldn't be a drug. Why is it? It should be removed from the drug reform. It's a plant, for God's sake. That word, you know? So that's all I've got to say. Speak up to your medical...
Thank you, and now let's hear from Marika.
Oh, wow. Next time someone tell me, don't go last. I'm emotional enough already, and that will become apparent as I speak. My name's Marika, and I don't have a child who needs... I have four children, and I would love to give them cannabis because I believe it's a food, but I don't have sick children. My involvement in all of this came through the Fearless Father campaign. Is there anyone here that doesn't know what Fearless Father is? Okay. Just to help me know what to speak about. In December 2014, a very beautiful, almost angelic little girl named Ruma
was diagnosed with stage 3 cancer. She has neuroblastoma, which not a lot is known about, but it is one of the most horrific, aggressive childhood cancers. There are about 700 children a year in US that are diagnosed with this. There's obviously no cure. Most of the children who get neuroblastoma die within the first couple of years, despite treatments. In the US, there's a little girl who has neuroblastoma, who 2 years ago was sent home to die after extensive chemotherapy, radiation surgery, stem cell transplant, everything. Her parents took her home, put her on medical cannabis, and changed her to an organic diet. They have just celebrated 2 years post-discharge, and she is cancer-free. So being aware of stories like this, when Rumour was diagnosed in 2014, her father, Adam, sourced cannabis oil and gave her cannabis oil, knowing full well that as parents, they didn't have the right to refuse chemotherapy. Had they refused chemotherapy once she was admitted to a hospital in Brisbane, the child would have been made a ward of the state. So they had no choice. However, they chose to use medical cannabis to try and ease the side effects of chemotherapy, radiation, keep her immune system supported. Unfortunately, the child's mother decided to inform the police and he was arrested on the 2nd of January last year. And I suppose through his journey, I've met all of these amazing people and realised the impact that anybody of these people could face. Because of the criminal charges against Adam, he lost his working with children's check, so he lost his job. He had worked for the Catholic Education Department for 12 years, was an outstanding member of community. He's a very tall but very humble, almost childlike man who does not have a malicious bone in his body. He's an extreme introvert, so this was an extremely difficult position for him to be in. His initial bail conditions said that he could not see his child at all, directly or indirectly. So we went to court, we had his bail conditions changed so that he could see his child given that she had cancer and only a 50% chance of survival. In order to see his child, he had to pay $1,000 a week for somebody to supervise his visits. If the child wasn't in hospital, he also had to hire a hotel room as well as pay for a supervisor. He lost his job so he didn't have any income, so he was another person in draining on the welfare system. The New Start payment is 70% below the accepted poverty line. So that's what he was trying to survive on while being relocated to Brisbane from Cairns, whilst trying to see his daughter, whilst trying to fight criminal charges. That wasn't enough, so there were family court proceedings started as well. So he not only had a criminal case, he also had a family court case, and I was involved in a lot of the legal side of that. Through those processes and through the just refusal of the Queensland government to consider the 220,000 signatures on a petition to the Queensland government calling for his charges to be dropped, it was completely ignored. Thousands and thousands of people have written to the federal and state governments for this man and his child, calling for the charges to be dropped. That was all ignored. Thousands of people contacted the DPP, which is the Director of Public Prosecutions. They were ignored. The hospital treated him like an axe-murdering pedophile, refused to let him see his child. I don't know how many meetings we had with the hospital saying, look, here are his bail conditions, here are the family court orders, you are stopping him seeing his child despite the fact he is jumping through every hoop, he is complying with everything that he has to do and he still can't see his child. For 6 months, he didn't see his child at all. All he had were reports from the hospital by phone after treatment had been done. Over the last 16 months, Rumour has had several rounds of chemotherapy. Then she had surgery to try and remove the tumour, but because it's wrapped around vital organs and major arteries and vessels near her heart, it can't be surgically removed. She then had an autologous stem cell transplant, which is essentially before they do chemo, they take out the child's stem cells to give them back at a later stage. They give them chemotherapy that kills every bit of their bone marrow. It kills all of their white cells. It kills their entire immune system. She lost weight. She stopped eating. So then she was nasogastric fed. She was in incredible pain. After that stem cell transplant, she spent time in ICU and almost died. The cancer didn't shrink, so they did 20 rounds of radiation. And they said, after the radiation, the cancer cells will be gone. The cancer cells weren't gone. So then they said, oh, well, we're not really sure what to do. Because her immune system was so weak, she got all sorts of infections that are everywhere. There's bacteria everywhere, everything you touch. We don't get sick from those bacteria because we have an immune system. This little girl had no immune system after conventional treatment. So then they decided to do more chemotherapy, which was done at the start of this year. Adam, in the meantime, hadn't seen his daughter for 6 months and obviously was in a very dark place, wondering if he was ever going to see her again, whether she lived or died, whether he was going to see her again, because his criminal case still hadn't been heard. On the 23rd of March this year, so over 12 months after he was arrested, he was taken to the Supreme Court, not the Magistrates Court or the District Court, but the highest court in Queensland. He was facing 25 years maximum penalty for giving his child medical cannabis. He was also facing 5 charges of possession because the police took his phone and he had 5 text messages on his phone from when they first started her on the cannabis oil, saying to his mother and his sister, saying, oh, wow, she's had it within the first dose. She's not complaining of pain. She's actually eaten a meal and she wants to go to the park and play. There were no negative effects from the medical cannabis. There were only positive effects, but she only had it for such a short amount of time that obviously it didn't have time to do anything to the cancer. On the 23rd of March, he went before the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court judge gave him no conviction and a 2-year good behaviour bond and told him to go and see his child. It cost hundreds of thousands of dollars of public funds to take this man before the Supreme Court. That's money that you've all spent to prosecute someone who just loves their child. If you don't know what Viola's father is, please look us up on Facebook. There are 75,000 people all around the world following this story. The tragedy of this from beginning to end is that because of one stupid law, a little girl who was suffering the most horrific treatments was denied access to a dad who loves her and who she loves. She wanted to see him every day. She didn't want him to leave. She would ask him, Daddy, please stay with me. Please don't go. Can you stay for a sleepover? And he had to leave. Because if he didn't, he was in breach of bail and he would have been arrested and gone to jail. The day after Adam came out of court, the doctors rang and said they'd done scans on Rumour and her cancer has now spread. They found lesions in her leg and it's in her bone marrow. They took her home and started her on a diet and they started her on cannabis oil. And it was helping her. She's now been returned to hospital where she will die. We know she will die. So Adam's message, I suppose, through me, he's gone back to Cairns because he's a very broken man. He's a very, very desperate man who knows that there's nothing more that he can do and that his child's life is now in the hands of the doctors who will put her back on the nasogastric feeds full of sugar that feed her cancer. They will pump her full of morphine, which feeds the cancer. She will die in pain and she will die without her dad there because the hospital is so obstructive. I spoke to him before he went home and I said, look at the millions of people around the world that you have connected through this journey. Look at the positive change that is growing. It's growing, but it's not happening yet. It's growing. Look at all the positive things that have come out. Look at the hell that you have survived. I mean, there were days, plenty of days, I would ring his mum and say, is he okay? Because we're expecting him to turn up dead in a ditch. There's only so much that anybody can take, no matter what they're fighting for. He said to me, yeah, Marika, I know. I got through all of that and it wasn't enough to save her. Nobody on this earth should ever have to go through a journey like that, especially when we know there is a child who has exactly the same diagnosis, her tumour is in exactly the same place, who is alive now because of cannabis oil and diet. Geographical location on this earth should not determine whether someone lives or dies. Not one of these parents should have to live in fear of a knock on the door. And they do. The only difference, I suppose, now is that we do have a precedent now in Adam's case going before the Supreme Court that the judge ordered no conviction. That's a very, very big message to the government. But it's also, I hope, I pray that through the hell that he has been through, that is a message for everybody else who is using for their children. Keep records. I can't say it enough. My background is in critical care nursing. Keep records every single day from the day that you start using cannabis, because when you stand before a judge in court and you can say, as most of these families now can, look at what my child was like 2 years ago or 6 months ago or even 3 days ago, because that's how quickly it works for a lot of people. If you have the evidence, there is no court in this land, no judge in this land who hopefully would say, yes, you're a criminal. I mean, it's just absurd. The hospital that this child is in, a lot of these parents have to go there. They've been told if you bring your child's life-saving medicine to a hospital who are supposed to save lives, we will report you and you will be arrested. The only way that this is going to stop is for people like us to go out and talk about how wrong this is. Go and see your politicians. Talk to doctors. Talk to the public. Talk to the media. Talk to your neighbours. Talk to the lady in the supermarket. Talk to everyone, because unless the people of Australia rise up and say, enough, stop doing this to people, stop doing it to their parents, stop doing it to these children. Unless we stand up and say enough, nothing is going to change. I don't care what the media is telling you. I don't care what your politicians are saying. It's horseshit. It is not true. Read the legislation. It does not say what the media says. They will drag this out and drag this out and drag this out. They will punish these people. They will allow these children to die and suffer. They will allow adults to suffer unless you stand up. Please do not let the hell that this man has gone through and the suffering that his little girl has gone through be in vain.
Thank you.
That's my message.
Thank you. Thank you, Marika. And now I'd like you to hear from Michael Harding. Michael, I'll let him tell his own story, actually. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you. My name's Michael Harding. This is my partner, Beck. I served for 4 years in the Royal Australian Army as an infantryman. I was deployed to Afghanistan in 2010, and during my deployment over there, I was involved in a 3.5 hour contact where my section 2IC was shot and killed. After that, I was returned back to Australia with full body involuntary muscular twitches and obviously a lot of psychological ailments. I started the conventional treatment, which, if many of you don't know, it's psychotherapy, talk therapy and a whole heap of pharmaceuticals. And within about 10 months, I'd put on about 30 to 40 kilos. I'd withdrawn from my partner, my parents. I'd turned to alcohol just to feel something over the mind-numbing pills that I was on. And I'd just write myself off on grog and go for a wander, pass out in gutters, throw up on myself. Beck would have to come and find me, pick me up, clean me up and take me home. This got to a point where I was just getting worse and worse and worse, and pretty much I was either going to end up in jail or dead. And thankfully, my partner, Beck, decided to make the ultimate shift and leave her job and take up being my carer at home to really help me out. We turned to alternative therapies, much against my psychiatrist's approval. And initially, we started off with cannabis, which really helped me with the withdrawals from a lot of the psych meds. As well as changing our diet and slowly incorporated a few things like yoga and flotation therapy and peer mentoring groups. Using all these things, I've been able to reconnect with who I am as opposed to just being a shell of myself. As people can relate, medications just sort of take away the person that's behind the shutters there, and you're just a blank sort of person walking around. So being able to interact with my family, go to family functions again, like when I first got back from Afghanistan, it was probably the first two or three years I didn't even go to Christmases or birthdays or Easters or anything. I just withdrew, stayed at home and drank alcohol. So we've started up an organisation called Weed for Warriors Project Australia. It's after a US-based group. And we're just trying to push a message, educate veterans and ex-service, so emergency services. I know they suffer from a lot of horrific scenes as well. So we're trying to educate them on getting into cannabis as opposed to the pills and the medication that majority of them have the side effect of suicide. Anecdotally, this year, we've lost 15 veterans to suicide already. Last year, it was 34 over the total of the year. And that's just anecdotally. We don't actually have a solid register of how many guys actually do take their own life. So we'd like to change that. We've prepared a short little video to play to give you an example of a group in Canada called Marijuana for Trauma. They've set up a group utilising cannabis and mateship to help heal PTSD.
Thanks, Michael. About Beck. Now let's hear from her.
So I'm Beck, Michael's partner and full-time carer. I met Michael first of all in primary school, but we were reconnected when we were 21, just before Michael went to army training. He was confident and outgoing, relaxed and confident and kind and caring. When Michael came back from Afghanistan, my expectation was to see that same person just in deep mourning, having lost a friend. However, in reality, he was a completely different man. He was deeply confused by his experiences, and he seriously struggled to express his feelings and emotions. His drinking habit was out of hand, and I eventually started inviting myself to go to his doctor's appointments. And I spoke to his psychiatrist about the amount that he was drinking along with the psychiatric pills that the doctor had prescribed. And his response to me was not what I was expecting, because he told me that what Michael was drinking was, in his opinion, normal for someone who was in the military. It was at this point it was my realization that I needed to step my game up and I needed to take control, not only to save my relationship, but to keep Michael alive. So, as Michael said, I reduced my hours at work, which then followed by me leaving full-time work, which then I started part-time work, which still did not give me the flexibility to support Michael when he needed me most. Anxiety attacks, flashbacks, dissociation can occur at any time and can be triggered by almost anything. So I did what any concerned loved one would do when the doctors weren't helping me, and I turned to Dr. Google, who then suggested that I try diet. So initially we detoxed Michael from his pills, alcohol, his pack-a-day smoking habit, and probably the worst of all, sugar. And we did that with fresh fruit and juice, fresh fruit and vegetable juice, as well as a raw food diet. And we did this also with the support of cannabis, which, as Michael said, it helped him dramatically with the withdrawals and the side effects. And we did that over a 10-day period, and he lost 14 kilos in that time. It was truly incredible to see. Over time, we continued to improve our diet. We started a daily exercise program as well as a yoga program, and Michael gained great benefit from peer-to-peer rehabilitation programs and volunteer groups. And in March 2014, we also included flotation therapy. And we combined flotation therapy with cannabis, we have not looked back from any of that. Cannabis really allowed, without cannabis, Michael wouldn't have done the peer-to-peer rehabilitation programs or being able to even go out and volunteer and get the benefits that he even does from that. And while this transition appears seamless, I can absolutely assure you it wasn't. We had so many ups and downs, and certainly being able to find and afford a quality supply for Michael was a constant concern of ours. When Michael was without cannabis, he was moody, irritable, was triggered by lots of things. He lost all motivation, which included his personal hygiene. Now, this was not withdrawal of cannabis or from a cannabis addiction. These are examples of symptoms of trauma. So cannabis has been an invaluable tool in helping Michael to manage his condition. In my opinion, cannabis is the only medicine that gives near instant relief from his debilitating anxiety, flashbacks, mood swings, and is the only medicine that heals the emotional wounds as well as managing the chronic pain conditions that so many veterans receive from their war service. For me personally, as a carer, it has allowed me and helped me to become a loving, supportive and understanding partner, a more resilient partner, and most definitely a more compassionate caregiver. It has allowed me to, it has helped support me deal with my own anxieties and mental health ride that I've been on, like the journey that I've been on with Michael and as his full-time carer that I started when I was 24 years of age. So it's been a very lonely and isolating journey for me. And without cannabis, I don't think we would have been able to get to where we are today.
Thank you. Thank you, Beck. Before we go into question time, would you please just help me thank these ordinary heroes? Now, I know this could get out of hand. I'm sure everyone here has got questions. Can I just ask, first of all, just for a show of hands, people who have been affected by the stories and what they've seen up there? Is that everyone? Keep your hands up if you would, because I'd just like to say, would you keep your hands up if you now intend to do something about this? Will you lobby your politicians, the local police, the doctors? Wonderful. Thank you. You realise that's a commitment and we've got you on film. No. But look, right now we're going to try and be as orderly as we can with this. And we'll start the questions. Who's got the first question? Please ask a particular member of the group up here, or a general question can be offered to the group and whoever might take it up and answer that question.
It's not actually a question.
Hang on.
But it is very important. Australia is the only country in the Western world that does not have a Bill of Rights. As we heard from Dana from Canada yesterday, they have a Bill of Rights. And the laws, etc., don't, like things like this would not happen because they've got a Bill of Rights. The Greens at the moment, I'm not politically aligned, but the Greens in New South Wales at the moment have taken it up and they are going to try and get a Bill of Rights in New South Wales. And that is something we need to lobby for. As Jeffrey Robertson said, QC, famous QC, we're going to need a Bill of Rights with these governments.
Yes, thank well, you so much. Something's got to keep the buggers in check. Eh? All right, now, can I ask for questions? And while I appreciate the statement, everyone's got a statement. But just now, to avail ourselves of the benefit of these people who have come along, please direct your questions about the issue. Thank you. Young lady there.
I'll throw it out to the panel. Your opinions on state trials then. I'll go to Tassie first, actually. Mal or Lynn, do you want to go? I want to know what you think of the trials.
Our government is going to grow cannabis for New South Wales. There will be a slight majority of people that they are trying to get aligned with New South Wales to do the trials. But I would say that 95% of Tasmanians are not interested in the trials.
Please don't wait. In 2003, Bob Carr in New South Wales, supported by John Howard, who was the Prime Minister at the time, announced 4 years of medical cannabis clinical trials. Never happened.
Why would a country patent it? I mean,
it's absurd, okay? Clinical trials... I believe research is important, yes, but what we did in Queensland last year is we put up a petition calling for amnesty. That is what we need. We need amnesty because if the growers, the carers, the people taking the oil, medical staff, if everyone has amnesty from prosecution, then the researchers can actually look at what's working now, what's working across the board for all of these people and all of these various conditions, and why does that work for that person but not for that person? We need amnesty, and we need research to help everybody, but these trials, if they ever happen, are so limited, they're going to give such limited information, which we can probably get from trials that have been and research done overseas. We don't need to reinvent the wheel, but please don't wait. Don't wait for clinical trials.
Okay, thank you.
So I just wanted to also say I don't believe trials are going to work. You know, if you take it out of the cannabis concept and go, it's like saying let's trial the apple when we're really dealing with the fruit salad. you know, there is so many cannabinoids that to trial, say, CBD and say, oh, well, that didn't work for any epilepsy patients or it only worked for 10%, so therefore cannabis failed, that's a joke. You know, I know kids on so many different combinations that I couldn't even sit here and tell you those combinations. So I don't believe the government's going to realistically get any good results, and they've almost set it up to fail.
Okay, it sounds like amnesty is the go.
One more thing about the trial. The New South Wales government's allocated $5 million for medical cannabis trials on epilepsy. I think they've allocated now $3.5 for Epidiolex CBDV. They have $1.5 million left. I'd love to see them do a trial on raw cannabis, like what Mulloway's makes. THCA, CBDA, raw cannabis. Let's do the test.
Okay, thank you. Is there another question?
Hi, I've got a 10-year-old little boy who had epilepsy as a baby, and now that he's starting puberty, he's just started having seizures again. So he started having little ones a year ago, and they've, because he got a cold, and that's all it can take sometimes, he's just started having seizures that are tonic-clonic seizures for 30 seconds to up to 4 minutes, and then for the next half an hour. Holding my little boy while he has complex partial seizures. And they're really quickly within, you know, I contacted the neurologist, I contacted the pediatrician, they're still getting back to me. That was a month ago. And through, so really quickly, he had four. So for 2 hours out of 24 hours, my little boy was having seizures. And they'd ring the ambulance and they'd get there after it had finished. But what are they going to do anyway? So through a friend of a friend, we organised some CBD oil for Annan, and it's really reduced them. We obviously need to play with it a bit, but he went from having four in 24 hours and he was still sick. It wasn't because he was suddenly not sick, but it massively reduced them. There's nothing more scary. He's had one seizure when it was little, they went for 38 minutes and it was totally silent. And I was just lucky I was awake. He was in bed next to me. And his head turned right to the right. And he couldn't do anything about it. He was face down in the pillow. And if I wasn't awake, holding his face off the pillow, I wouldn't have my boy. We need help. Our kids need help. We need access to this help.
Look, thank you for that. And can I suggest to that lady that she meet up after this meeting with anyone here from the panel? Okay, 5 o'clock tonight. Where is it? Disco City Central. They'll be here to talk, but please, so that you're not alone. Okay.
Can I just say something quickly? Definitely at 5 o'clock today, we've set up a session down at the Indica Arena, which is Disco Sisters' tent. So if anyone would like to go and have a chat to some of the Medican families and get to know each other, that's a good space to do it.
Thank you, Kathy. Is there another question? I'm sure there are people out here who've had experience.
I'm so sorry. My question actually wasn't my story. I'm sorry about that.
I couldn't get the question, but I got the emotion.
So. I know, I'm sorry. My question is that school's just gone back. He had a seizure at school at the end of last term, which is when it had just started happening. They're asking me, what's happening? What's happening with medication? What's happening for him? I have anxiety about being honest to them because they're mandatory reporters. I have lots of anxiety about that, but I want to stand up and say, we haven't fixed it entirely, but, you know, because we need to change a few things with the strain and everything, but it's massively reduced it immediately from four seizures within the 24 hours to nothing for you. Anyway, so my question is, how do we deal with that, with our anxiety of dealing with the education system and hospitals? And I want to be able to stand up and do that, but do I? Can I? Can I do that yet?
The first thing I'd want to know is what state you're in.
New South Wales.
New South Wales is probably, you probably can get away with telling them. Victoria, do not hesitate to tell them. In Victoria, my child is administered medical cannabis by her aide or by her teacher at least twice a day. And that is in a mainstream government school. My son is in a Christian private education setting and is also given his medical cannabis in school. It is chartered by their doctors and we don't have any issues. If you're in Queensland, forget it. Don't tell them because they will report you.
No, not in our case.
Not, it's getting better.
As like yeah. In our case, this, oh, sorry. I'm from Queensland. In our case, my son's been at the same school for the last 6 years. They've seen him at his very worst, where he was wheelchair bound, nasal gastric fed. Seizure after seizure, up to 500 seizures a day. He went to school for half days to be babysat. As I was saying before, he now has his first academic report. He's now able to be graded. So the school, when December 2014, when Jai actually regressed and we took the leap and gave him his first dose of cannabis, we were in that position, or the school actually believed Jai would not be attending school the following year. We actually took Jai down to say his goodbyes. He didn't know who his teachers were, never had a friend. He couldn't put two and two together. That was just our normality. So when he did return to school, everyone wanted to know why he was walking, why he was talking, why he was eating, why he had energy, and why now he was prepared to learn. First thing I did was I told our GP, got our GP on board. I said, report me. This is what I'm using. This is the information I have. He said, give me a minute, had a look at Jai. He said, it's the best I've seen him in 5 years. So I'm not going to report you because you're not doing any harm, but what I do suggest is you tell the school. The school are going to know why, you know, in literally just the Christmas holiday periods, why it's doing so well. So I did. And as I did, we actually appeared again. I've done 43 or 44 media interviews, but I appeared on TV that night with the police minister, where they're like, here in Queensland, we're looking at doing the trials, and I'm like, don't wait. I'm not waiting. This is my address. This is where we live. This is my son. I've recorded everything, kept documents, you name it, and make sure I had a solid case. So with Queensland, the school know he needs a midday dose. They're on our back saying he's well and truly wanting to learn. He's capable now of learning. He needs to be here full time. That's great. What are you going to do for me? They won't put anything in paper. Our neurologist knows. Our neurologist has written letters saying they will not report us to child services because he had three syndromes. One is now existing. Two disappeared in 8 weeks. So, and the rarity of his epilepsy syndromes, you know, each seizure does do a bit more damage. The likelihood, as I said before, he wouldn't be here. So now he's just a child that is normal. So so we're in that situation where the school knows he has it. They want him there full time. The neuro knows he has it. Doctor knows, community knows, everyone. I've got no one left to tell, but no one will put anything in writing. So Victoria's great. New South Wales, I'm the same. I believe you'll be right in speaking up. But us, we're still stuck. I have to still pick Jai up. And he now understands that I am. He didn't want to come home. So it breaks my heart that I'm excluding him now from an everyday education. So, but no regrets speaking up. If it's working, say it. Document it. Mm-hmm. Have proof. We have 38 EEGs, 36 just on pharmaceutical that say nothing ever helped. We have two now, medical cannabis, 8 weeks apart, two syndromes gone. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Yeah.
I just want to say something about the legal side of that. There is nowhere in Australia where the law has changed. So the law is still the same, and police do have discretion. They did even in Adam's case. They could have done their investigation and signed off, not in the public interest. A lot of what we're hearing behind the scenes at the moment is that when people are reported, the case is closed faster than it's been opened, because it is very public now. There has been so much media about medical cannabis. There's also been, changes in legislation or discussion of changes. But the law as it stands, mandatory reporting has not changed. The laws have not changed. We just last week got a letter from Cameron Dick, the health minister in Queensland, saying that the Queensland government is not, under any circumstances, considering or willing to consider amnesty for medical cannabis patients. It is against the law, and they will enforce the law. That's Queensland. In New South Wales, it's no different. The discretion is happening at the police level or at the docs level, but when you get up into the political level or even into the higher police ranks, the law is the law, doesn't matter. Even if they introduce a medical cannabis program here for adults, which they're talking about doing in New South Wales, you will not be exempt from drug testing if you drive your car. So we're going from one side to the other. And the other is what needs to change. And the people are the ones that need to change it.
Thank you. Are there any more questions?
On the culture of secrecy and non-disclosure, what happens with fellowship programs like NA and AA? How do they feel about medical cannabis? Do they have an overt position? Because there will be people, surely, who are members of NA or AA who may need to use medical cannabis. Is there a conflict there? Does anyone know anything about that?
Well, I think you'll find that groups and organisations like NA and AA have no opinion on outside issues. And while this is not necessarily an outside issue, it's one that the legality of it, I think, would be something that would be left up to the individual. I tell them that I'm on wherever I go, and I'm telling my oncologist, and I had him admit to me the other day, he said, we kill a lot of people with chemotherapy and radiation, but we save a few. But these days they've got drugs now that work on the immune system. One of those I'm on, together with the cannabis, but together with a whole range of other protocols that have kept me alive for 12 years. I tell anyone who'd listen, because I would hope at one stage they might pull me, and whatever profile I've got as an actor, I'm happy to use that in this cause. Because without it, and without all of us standing up, you don't have to have any celebrity status. It's just the individual's passionate. After watching what we've seen here and heard here today, nobody could be unaffected. I mean, there's probably someone from the police or a government organisation here today watching this. I defy them to be unaffected by what they've seen and heard here today. So the law is an ass in this instance, and it needs to be changed, and it will only be changed through you, not through what these people have gone through. That can be the catalyst, but it'll come from you, individuals who get their neighbours and their friends to lobby and continue to lobby until this just becomes unassailable. And that's what it's going to take. And that's why I call these people pioneers, because they're the ones who are sticking their hand up at the moment. But look at what they've got to justify that. And who could be against that? No one in their right mind, or no one with a heart. So it's going to be a struggle that'll go on for a while. But I think it's up to each and every one of us to do what we can, where we can, with whom we can. Is there another question? Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Can I just say I know a lot of these families up here, and I do a fair bit of advocating in Queensland. When you're going to speak to your health directives, whether it's a doctor, an acupuncturist, physio, whatever, you make sure you let them know they have a duty of care to you. So like they need to know what Lyrica or Valium or any of these other drugs do, if you walk in there and say, I'm on medicinal cannabis, they have a duty of care to be educated. They all got into health at one point or another because they want to make a difference. This medicinal cannabis, these families, these kids, this is where they make a difference, and every one of you can play a part. Like everyone said, get into your politicians' ears. I walk in, and I'll admit it, I've walked in with medicine. There you go. There's a bloody tincture that you're arguing about that is saving life. Where's the bloody bong? There is no bong. This is the life-saving medicine, and you must, every opportunity you get, each one to each one is a massive saying here in Nimbin. You have a duty of care to each other, but they've got a massive duty of care to you to know about the medicine you're taking, and they won't find a bad story. They won't.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Do we have another question? There's a lady there with a...
Just on that for a minute, I had a workplace accident myself, and I see psychiatrists, I see physios, and from day one I've told them all. It's been ongoing now for 5 years, and now they send us their hopeless cases that they can't fix. They send them to us.
And just on the ridiculousness of that situation, Marika was speaking before of Adam and his plight. I am a registered nurse. This is Queensland. Adam was paying for a registered nurse to be present for his supervised visits with his daughter. It was costing him a fortune. He was broke. I said, I'll do it. I wasn't allowed. Now, I can be a registered nurse to any of you on any of my ward in the main acute hospital in Queensland, but I was not allowed to stand there and be present for this man so it wouldn't cost him for the hour to visit his daughter. That is how ridiculous it is. How is that easy? How does that even work? You know, my registration is no...
The reason she couldn't was because she supports cannabis medicine. The public prosecutor had to sign off on every person who was going to be approved. They ran a history check, and if you were related to medical cannabis in any way whatsoever, if you've made a public positive statement, you were not allowed to supervise him. So we were using... contact centres and things costing thousands.
Yep. Okay. Is there a question from the floor?
No, I don't think so.
Is that it?
Yep.
Okay.
I just want to say thank you to Michael for your service.
Thank you, Michael. Please thank all of the people up here today.
And thanks very much, Tony, for coming in and comparing. And
thank you.
Yes, it's really very cool. Thank you.
Thanks, Kath. Yep. Thank you. Thank you. And remember, it is up to us. Nothing's going to change. And laws are changing. There's a quantum shift in consciousness coming. And I was here in 1973 for the Aquarius Festival, like I said, when I was a practicing hippie. Now I'm a... unfrocked hippie, but I'm still conscious in here that what started here in 1973 was to challenge some of what was going on out there. So it's taken a long time to get this far, and it's going to take a lot longer, but there's more and more people, as we've heard here today, find the benefits of cannabis oil, and as that starts to develop and they start leaving the doctors to one side, the doctors, as they did with acupuncture, will do a six-week course on it and learn about it. The doctors will start prescribing this. That's how I see it in the end. All we've got to make sure is that it doesn't fall into the hands of the beer barons or the other thugs and corporate thugs out there that will try and manipulate and control it. This is why I think this area is so important. Okay, well, thanks again for attending. And...
Just before you go, can I just say that this could change overnight? It truly could. One signature on a piece of paper could change this overnight for everyone in Australia. Because at the end of the day, I've spoken to I don't know how many politicians now, as have we all, and one thing that I've found is, you know, before I went to speak to them, I thought, oh, they're all corrupt. They're all got the pharmaceutical companies in their pockets and, you know, they're all just out there to get us the buggers. And then when I started talking to them, I realised they have no idea. They don't know the first thing about health, medical cannabis, about THC, about CBD. They don't know anything because they're just given the same information that everyone else is that keeps them in the dark. And they're just human beings. They go home to their husbands or wives, their children, their lives. And you know what? Most of them use cannabis. And if they're not using cannabis, they're using something else, whatever their drug of choice is. So I find that, you know, a lot of people go, oh, but they're a politician, they're in this position of power. No, they're not. They're another human being. And the thing that irks me and keeps me doing this, as hard as it is to watch these families struggle, is the fact that I believe that there is no human being on this earth should have the right to tell me or anyone else, can I live or should I die? Should my children suffer? Or is it okay to give them cannabis oil? Now, I've got four teenage children who I know have educated themselves. Their father is a doctor very high up in the system, and they've told him, Dad, if we get sick, we ain't coming anywhere near you. We're going to Mum with her diet, no medical cannabis. Because they've educated themselves. Now, if we start educating other people, just talk to them normally. It doesn't have to be a big confrontational thing. Just talk to them because we are all human beings. We all relate on some level to someone who's ill, someone who has cancer, someone who's suffering, someone who's lost someone. Even the police, they go home to their children. Now, the police have said about Adam's case across Australia, if they were in that position again, yes, they would do the investigation because that is what they're required to do, and then they would sign it off saying not in the public interest and it would go no further.
Thanks, Marika. Can I just ask, is this, you're filming this, and what do you intend to do with the film?
Yeah, we have a YouTube channel and we were going to put it on that.
Okay, well, if everyone here finds out the address of that YouTube channel, writes it down on a little piece of paper, and next time you go to your doctor or a police person or a politician and you give them that and ask them, in the interests of health and legality, would they have a look at it, then they will get access to this meeting. They will hear what you had to say. They will hear what these people had to say, and they'll get to see some of the effects of cannabis, because Marika is right. They're locked up in cocoons. They don't know what's going on. There's an old Australian saying, you can't educate a mug, and the half-smart mugs are the hardest ones of all to educate. There's a lot of half-smart mugs in positions of power out there, and it's up to us to show them that they've got no clothes, not to mix the metaphors up too much. But if you guys could find out, where will that be available?
I reckon we'll put it on Facebook and we'll have it on our website and, people can call us as well.
And we can disseminate it from there. Thanks again for attending and thank you again to the panel.
Yeah, thanks so much, everybody. That's really special for you to come and share those very, very private stories, really.